Hello and welcome to episode 1 of R4nger5 TV. I'm here in the new set. If you've ever seen any of the other R4nger5 output, we've never had anything as grand as a set and lighting and stuff like that. So this is our first try at using it. This week's episode is all about providing the bare necessities for yourself, food, water, and the ability to prepare those. So in future episodes we'll be covering things like bushcraft survival, how to sort of withstand the effects of sudden economic change in your life, or a power cut, or our favourite code word for everything going wrong, zombie apocalypse, which will always be used in a very tongue-in-cheek way. So please don't think we actually think that zombies will come shambling through the world. It could be a sudden political upheaval. It could be, you know, sudden changes to your personal economics, all that sort of thing. So we're going to try and upskill you, re-equip you, and make you more resilient to sudden change. That's the goal. So on with the first segment, which is about setting up a short-term storage of food and water and preparing that if you suddenly need to. Let's get on with it. Okay, so what I put together for today's demonstration is what I'd like to call a basic prepper's larder. So it's a few days worth of food and water that would enable you to get by, to have other stuff added to it, things like tea and coffee, and you know, if all the electricity went out, you'd need to use up all the things in the fridge as soon as possible, things in the freezer ditto, get them cooked, get them eaten. And this is more just really adding to your abilities to sort of stretch out what you have. So what I've done is I've put together a few items, and the way I paid for them was pretty unique as well. We've all got small change, and it's all scattered throughout the home. And what I did is I gathered it all together into the penny pot, which I hadn't emptied out in a good couple of months. And the total of all the very small change, 10p, 5p, 2p and 1p, that sort of thing, all came to £6.40. So I went and used an exchange machine, just got a little voucher to use at my local supermarket out of the machine. I don't know if you have them elsewhere in the world. And just consolidated that money that really wasn't doing anything. I probably wasn't going to carry it around in order to spend it. So this is purely extra money that had just gathered up from the odds and ends of other things I'd purchased. So I took that money and tried to put together a good few days worth of survival food. I typically went for the value stuff from the local supermarket. It wasn't a huge supermarket, it's just a smallish localised one. And they don't have all the things that I would like to have got. But so this was just a quick trip to the supermarket, spend the money in the penny pot, and extend my ability to be comfortable in addition to the other things that I have in my kitchen. So the first thing I bought, and probably the most important, is water. Now, bottled water, if you buy non-branded bottled water, and in my opinion it's all the same, is probably the smartest thing you can stock up on. If the water gets cut off, people are going to be exposed to very, very contaminated water, the sewage system will back up, things like that. Having a few days of water will make you much more resilient to sudden change. And I would say that it should be the first thing, even if you only have a dollar or 50p to spend, the first thing you should get is some still bottled water. Leave it sealed. I've taken the labels off because it identifies the supermarket. But leave it sealed, put it somewhere dark, cool and dry, and you'll always have an option if the water suddenly stops. It also means that for the first few days, purifying and gathering water is not your immediate priority. You can focus on other things if you want to, or if you have to. Next up is rice. Pretty much half the planet relies on rice as a staple food. It's good stuff. You can prepare it overnight and heat it with very little energy. It's fantastic stuff. You should have as much of it as you possibly can. 3 to 5 billion people on Earth can't be wrong. So get yourself the cheapest version of long grain rice. Cooks just the same. I personally prefer basmati rice, but it's nice to have a whole kilo. And that was just 40 pence for a kilo. Next up, some spaghetti. So you can add that as noodles to other things to bulk out something else you're cooking. It's easy to cook. You can even pre-soak it if you want to. It's fabulous stuff, and spaghetti is the cheapest form of pasta. What we're going here is getting the most bang for buck food-wise. So I remind you, I spent £6 or probably about $7.50 just putting together an extra few days worth of supplies. And all this stuff will keep for an extremely long time. So it's all tinned, it's all in packets, it all has preservatives, it will all last for an extremely long time. But moving on to our next thing, which doesn't look like it's long-term packaged, but simple pasta and tomato sauce, dried pasta with a powdered tomato sauce, just add boiling water, heat it up, and you're good to go. That's a whole meal. And I got three of those. Those were 20 pence each, or probably about 30 cents. Well worth having. In my opinion, better than ramen noodles. You can get ramen noodles for about the same price. But, you know, nothing beats, you know, something warming that you actually like to eat. And I love these. I've taken them on lots of camping trips. I did find one of these, and I stress the word find, in my camping backpack that had been there for a couple of years, well past its sell-by date. I cooked it and ate it, and it was still fine. So you've probably got a good few years of storage of these, despite what it says on the best before date. Next up, we have sardines. Anything tinned pretty much has, as long as the tin is in good shape, an infinite shelf life. Don't be fooled by a use-by date. If it's tinned, it's not got dents or any piercings in the can, you can use it forever, and you can reuse the cans for useful metal tools and stuff like that. Workable thin metal's hard to come by. So I got myself some sardines, because they're great, which means that you can just add those. They've already got oil with them, so you can actually drain off the oil and use it for cooking other things, or you can use it as a source of fuel. So that's pretty good, and these will keep forever. I got some chicken soup, because chicken soup, which you can add noodles or rice to. I got some baked beans, because baked beans are a staple and everybody can eat them. So if you've got vegetarians or vegans about in your party, or the people you're trying to look after, you've got food. And that's a thing to bear in mind. All the food that you prep, all the food that you put by, should be something you're actually prepared to eat. I really worry about some people when I've seen what they've prepared, and they've prepped loads of long-term food, and they've never, if you ask them whether they'd like to eat it, the answer is always no, and it hasn't occurred to them. So always make sure it's something that you'd actually like to eat. Ideally, comfort food like chicken soup, hot drinks and stuff like that are going to be ideal for coffee and stuff like that. Speaking of which, this, I don't know if you can get it in the rest of the world, possibly, is evaporated milk. Now, it's kind of the sort of milk that your grandma might keep or your granddad might keep to put in their tea and coffee. It's essentially milk with an awful lot of the water taken out, and it's canned. So it'll keep forever. But if you add it to coffee, there's a sweetness to it because it's condensed, and you won't need to use as much of it. So a can of this would go a very long way. I've also indulged in some ready-to-serve custard because it's really high in calories, and some peaches because, you know, it's kind of a dessert. So you've got three desserts for two people pretty much there, half a can of each for each. And it's nice to have a dessert if you've had to put a meal together with scratch, and all you'd need to do is tip both cans into something. It's got light syrup, so that's something you can drain off and drink, and it's also high in calories, and that'll keep you going. So we've got probably about 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Probably about 10 main meals if you've really got it, and 6 desserts, some evaporated milk for tea and coffee to keep you going an extra few days, and 3 days of water for one adult. An adult will go through around 2 litres of water a day. You can stretch that out, but it's really not a good idea. You can survive 3 days without water, but day 2 and 3, well, the afternoon of day 1, day 2 and day 3 are going to be very miserable. You will hallucinate, you will be in very bad shape. It's not like you'll be able to search for water. If you haven't got water day 1, really, you are kind of screwed. So if you don't plan to keep some water, you better know where your nearest stream is, and you better have the fuel and the means to boil that water. And finally, the last thing I'd like to add is salt. Salt is absolutely necessary for human life to continue. It's something that you can add to nearly all food and improve the flavour. It's a means of preserving meat, especially pork and fish, and it's a tradable good. Even if you live on an island, like I do, being the UK, and you are surrounded by water and oceans, and those oceans have salt in them, creating salt from salt water or mining salt is a really unpleasant, long-winded, industrial process. It's work. Boiling a 50-gallon drum of seawater would yield you a couple of pounds of actual salt. So if you can imagine an oil drum filled with seawater, boiled down, you'd get about this. This is just under 2 pounds of salt, and it's dirt cheap in the Western world. It's one of the cheapest things you can buy. Please don't get into things like rock salt unless you have more money and you don't want to spend it on other more useful things. But cheap cooking salt is impossible to produce if you're in an urban environment and you need salt. You can use it to treat cuts and wounds. You can use salt water to flush out ulcers in your mouth. You can cure blisters on feet with salt, a salt water bath. Salt does it all. And it's a really useful trade item. I dread to think if suddenly imports stopped to a country, how much that 1.5 kilos of salt would suddenly be worth as a trade item. So you can use it for all sorts of things. It's fabulously useful. And you can't live without it. So salt and water and food, that's all kind of wrapped up. And all you need to do is look down the back of the couch, collect up all your pennies, get them converted into usable money. I did find that the automatic checkout units will take about £2 or £3 of small change before they start rejecting it. I've never managed to put the entire penny pot into them, which is why I basically converted it into a voucher so that I could use it. Those voucher machines do charge you about 10% of what you'd be able to spend, so that would be down to you. So that's what I put together in my... This was money that didn't really exist for me. I translated it into long-term food storage. All this stuff I can expect to keep for a number of years, and... You know, the canned stuff infinitely, the salt will pretty much keep forever. You'd need to keep the rice and the pasta in their packaging, so you might need to think about repackaging the pasta, and we'll go into that on a later episode. But if you don't do anything else, if all you find is about 60p, bottled water is absolutely paramount. At least keep some of that, and just like 3 days worth for yourself, or if there are more people in the household, try and keep about 3 days of water for drinking to hand, because you never know. There have been numerous disasters where people have been cut off and the water's been cut off, and lots of them have suffered from things like cholera and typhus because they couldn't access clean drinking water. There have been numerous occasions where people have been cut off from water in Northern Ireland, and I hate to bring it up and use it as a means to explain it to you, but Hurricane Katrina, where New Orleans was cut off, clean drinking water was one of the things that people most desperately needed. So help yourself out. Make sure you've got as much clean water as you feel you can store. Get it in storage. Get it sorted. And then start building up your preps. And this is not in case of a disaster. This is just supposing you have a bad pay month, or you can't work and you're on statutory sick pay, or you suddenly have less money than you thought you did. This will take the edge off suddenly being deprived of actual cash. All you need is food, warmth, water and shelter. And you can muscle through. You know, you can read books. You can do other things with your spare time. But this will eke out the resources that you already have. But how would you cook these resources if everything's cut off, V? Well, let's solve that one too. Jump to outside broadcast unit. Well, this I believe is the answer. I've got two of these. This is a 9-pound stove that I found on eBay from China. As far as design goes, I think it's basically a rip-off of the design for the Silverlight stove. As I said, this cost me £10. It works by burning the wood gas as well as the wood, so you get a very efficient fire, and it's very, very hot. And I've used this several times to cook food. And it'll burn meths and wood and anything else combustible, including bamboo. Thanks very much to Digital Whiskey for trying that out. That was a very interesting conversation we had, but the bamboo will stain and put a waxy residue on the thing, which I don't think is a problem. But we're going to fire this up, and I'm going to show you it in action burning wood. Here we go. Jump cut. So it's been raining for 2 or 3 days straight, so the wood is very damp. And a little tip for you, you want wood that hasn't been on the ground, so you want to snap off twigs that are on any wood that's lying down but hasn't been in actual contact with the ground. And you only need a handful of twigs to get this going. But it is very smoky at the moment. Normally with dry wood, it will just kick in
and you won't get anything like this smoke. This is just establishing itself, and it's throwing out quite a bit of smoke. So the interesting thing is this is throwing out so much smoke that the little remote that I used to trigger the camera for recording has wouldn't actually, the remote LED wouldn't fire through the smoke that this is throwing off, but it is burning. I've just put a pan of water on. This is a little pan that actually I bought for the Kelly kettle as part of a Kelly kettle cook kit, and this actually fits inside the stove when it's folded up and up and not in use, and it seems to be doing quite well. So I'm a real big fan of this stove system. I used to have a Bush Buddy, which is the Rolls-Royce of wood gasifier stoves as far as I'm concerned, but they cost about £70, and that's no good if you're just prepping for having to cook for yourself without any main services or utilities running. So there are small bubbles in this, so it is probably quite hot. I'll just so it's actually coming up to the boil. Just give it another couple of minutes. If you do find that the fire's dying down, all you need to do really is lift the pan off. This is why you should always carry a multi-tool with pliers on it, like so. And when I take the pan off, you'll see there's a lot more flame in it than it looks like with the pan on top. And literally just pop a few choice twigs in, which will mean that it'll start smoking again if the wood's all wet. This is why, if you have any kind of warning, or this is your second day without utilities and you've decided to switch to this, you probably want to get some wood drying just in case. And I'm using a very low-tech wired microphone for this, so it has to be said that I will someday move on to the wireless microphone, because doing this one-handed is a bit tricky. Now, you can get standard pot lifters, but what I have with me is the Leatherman. And we just wait for it to come to the boil. The reason most people on bushcraft sites study how long something takes to boil a pan of water is that if you can boil water, you can cook stuff, basically. And water is the easiest thing, so you can run that together and put yourself a brew together. And you'll find with people that come out to parks to test out their equipment or find wild places that are nearby their homes, generally speaking, they'll come out, have a brew, check out their equipment, and then go home. They won't cook a main meal out. Of course, there's nothing stopping you from taking out some pasta and things and cooking yourself something while you're out in the woods. And it's always a good idea, wherever you live, most cities still have wild woodland somewhere near them, and it's worth taking a wander out and worth getting yourself familiar with that piece of woodland. And we'll move on to that and show you why that's a good idea to have a piece of pet woodland right near where you live, so you can practice and try out your kit and get used to using it. So this is actually boiling in real time. I don't know whether I'll do a jump cut to cut to it or whether I'll just make you all sit and watch, you know. But it's nice to sort of sit around the fire. It's throwing off quite a bit of heat. It's quite a cold day. I'm filming this on the 1st of February 2017. So it's quite nice to sit near something that's got a fire on it. And the smoke is giving me a runny nose. It will do that. So we're back, and as you can see, the flames are get a bit more established now, and the water's pretty much coming to a boil. If I was making a coffee and I was feeling impatient, I could make coffee with it now. If you're purifying water, just bringing it to the boil, there's a myth that says you've got to boil water for 3 or 4 minutes to make sure all the bacteria are dead, and boiling won't get rid of any heavy metals or particulates that are in the water, but it will kill any bacteria that'll up and kill you. But this is pretty much boiling now, and I'd say it's been running for about 3 or 4 minutes. So probably 5-6 minutes to heat up a pre-cooked meal, something like a can of beans, or, you know, anything in a can generally will only take a few minutes to heat up, and it's now, it's actually just kicked into a rolling boil. You possibly can't see that with the camera, but we'll have a look. So there we go, a change of shot there. And that's the water boiling. So that literally only took a few minutes with just a bunch of twigs that I pulled off a tree. Very much like this one. So this is what I mean by standing dead wood. It's not actually on the ground, but it's dry and you can snap it and it makes a satisfying crack sound as you pull off the thing, off the bits. You only need a piece of wood that's about 2 or 3 inches long. You break it into 2 or 3 inch lengths and just pop it in the bowl and start your fire. We'll be covering fire starting in another segment. So just... But yeah. And we'll just go back to the glory of boiled water, which if you haven't camped out, you know, having a hot drink is of paramount importance. So I use no fuel from home. This is literally sticks I gathered on the walk over to set this all up. And this is in my local woodland. So yeah, if you do buy one, get out and use it. Get used to starting a fire, however you plan to start it. Today I used just a couple of fire lighters. Obviously those would run out eventually, so things like matches, fire steels, flint and steel, those things would be used to, you know, well worth getting used to using. And we'll cover those in later episodes. I promise you, this is not a thing I'm just going to vaguely promise. We'll have a look at flint and steel and fire steel and char cloth and things like that that are more permanent solutions to getting fires lit. But today, it's wet, I used fire lighters. And voila, boiling water. The root source of all your ability to cook. And when you've finished cooking, this is all that should be left. The wood burns so completely, it just burns down to ash. And this is because the wood gasifier stove burns everything, even the wood gas. So the initial smoke that was coming off was pretty much down to the dry wood. Once you've got a fire started and it's burning, it will just burn completely down to ash, which you can then safely dispose of. Always make sure that you've put out any embers. If you are going out to your local woodland, make sure that the fire is extinguished, and then when you're finished, even if you think the ash is cold and there are no glowing embers at all, always make sure you pour a little bit of water on it. Or in the expedient nature, or if you've run out of water, you've probably had a brew, so wait a little while, and there's no polite way of putting this, just have a quick piss on where you've put the ashes. Just make sure that you don't ruin a woodland for anybody else, and make sure that you're responsible while you're out there. So now we're going to look at the other way to use this stove that I've found that's easy to do, using a pop can meth stove. And these are very easy to make. You either find a beer can or a soft drinks can, and you cut it up in a certain way, and it makes a little twin-walled stove that you can use instead of burning wood. The advantages of this is you don't have to hunt around for fuel. You can try it out indoors because it won't cause any smoke. It's much more stealthy, and yeah, it's a really good way of doing it. A 500ml bottle of meths will last you about a weekend if you're doing 3 meals a day and drinks. So without further ado, we're going to put that in. You may notice that the base of the fire, the little segment inside the stove, is higher because the meth stove will need to be closer to the pan for heating it up. And all you do is you just swap around the fire pan, just put it in the other way up, and you can use it for burning meths. So I'm just going to jump cut to putting the meth stove in, and we'll fill it with meths and we'll boil some more water. There may be a lot of boiling water in this segment. So here's my meth stove. It's 2/3 full of meths. It's the purple liquid you can see inside. I've made this out of one of those narrower energy drink style soda cans. And so we're just going to light that. And the easiest way to do that, it's going to be a lighter, but you could theoretically use a fire steel. So we just need to light that and let it establish itself. And then we'll put the water on top. Well, we're going to light that when I can find my lighter, which is around here somewhere. So although you can't see it, or you may only just be able to see it, that's now lit. Meth burns with a very pale flame, so you can possibly see it going now. And this meth stove has like got piercings all the way around the outside of the tin and a second wall inside. So now that's pretty much established. We're going to put on our pan of water again and just bring that to the boil. But as you can see, it acts very well, produces quite a lot of flame, and it's very hot, but your pan does need to be very close to the flames. So we're just going to do that now. And I'd like to say that this goes without saying, but make sure that when you set up one of these, the stove itself is on as level a surface as you can possibly manufacture. If you can't get a level surface, it's worth considering making a platform out of sticks that you find in the woods, and just get it as level as you possibly can and as stable as you possibly can, because if this thing tips over towards you, or it's just going to be aggravating losing water that you may well have had to have gone and got from a stream, or you may have a limited supply, and it's pretty scary when it does it. So make sure it's level. It's quite got quite a nice wide base, so you only have to have something that's vaguely level, but stability is the very, very most important thing. So now we're just going to wait for it to boil. While we're waiting for that, you may notice that the only thing that's coming off that, instead of all the smoke that was coming off the wood, is the steam, the evaporation from the water itself. And again, I can't stress this enough. If the meth all burns out and your water still hasn't boiled, what you're going to need to do is take the pan off, wait for the meth burner to cool down. Usually takes about 5 or 10 minutes until you can touch it without burning yourself. So tap it gently to make sure that it's cool enough before you put any more meths in, because you'll be pouring meths from a bottle. And if you ignite the meths as it's pouring into the bottle, the entire bottle will start burning, which is a very unpleasant thing. Being on fire is bad. If you are on fire, you have done this completely wrong. And if you are outside in the woodland, you can probably hear all the birdsong that's rather beautifully playing while we do this. As you can see, we've got some bubbles forming now. This is after about 2 minutes. And I would say this is probably hot enough. If you're making coffee with powdered milk, this is probably as hot as you want it, if you're sure of the water source. I'd give it another 30 seconds or so if this is water that you've got from a stream, just to make sure any bacteria are well and truly dead. So it's not quite a rolling boil. but I think you can call that a rolling boil. So that's the water purified and ready to make your brew with. Now, there's another safety tip. The problem with meths is that once you've put it into the meth stove, you probably don't want to tip it back into the bottle because it would be too hot. These stoves are designed so that you can't really blow them out, and nor would you really want to get that close to burning meths to do it. So once you've put fuel into it, that it's kind of gone. So when you do measure out your fuel, do it carefully. Have an idea of how much you normally put in, or even maybe put a mark on the side of the meth can as to what size of pot and the amount of water that you put into it. But these things are only learned with practice. So I'm going to take the pot off the boil now. And this is where you want a cameraman, really, or a camera person. So if you can just see, possibly in the bottom there, hold on, I'll see if I can get in tighter. No, that's about as close as I can get. There is about a millimetre of meths left in the bottom, and you will really need to just let that burn out and let the meths burner cool down properly. But it's a very cheap way of adding extra functionality to a wood burning stove, is that generally speaking you can put a little tiny meths burner in it and use it as a dual fuel cooker if you want to carry meths with you. If you are travelling or you're out and about, you can keep your eyes open for meths, but generally speaking a 500ml bottle of meths will last you a whole weekend. I would say use wood first and preserve fuel that you can't get easily out in the wild. And so you've got like basically the best of both worlds, really. And the other advantage of this is you can use meths to cook indoors with, but if you do plan to do that, be amazingly careful and make sure that the stove is on a very flat surface and it's sitting on top of something that you don't mind getting a bit scorched. Do not use these burners indoors if you're using wood. If you need to use it indoors, build up a supply of meths. So our stove is all cooled down now. If you're not sure before you put it away, if you have spare water, just pour a little bit over the stove just to get it cooled down enough that you can put it in the bag that it comes in. So it does come in a nylon bag, so if you try and put it away hot, you will just melt the bag and then the parts of the stove will be rattling around. So I'm going to take it apart for you and give you a look at all the component bits, because it does come in separate sections. So there's the pot holder. There's the fire pan, which we reversed in order to balance the meth stove on. So that goes, you know, down if you're burning wood and up if you're burning meths. And you've got these two ring segments. So I'm just going to pop it away in its bag and you can have a look at it all packed down. So that's the stove, the pan I was using, and the little meth burner all packed down. Now, the parts will rattle around a bit, so you might want to include something like a scrubby sponge, which is handy to have anyway, and or a small tea towel or half a tea towel, and that'll stop it from rattling when it's in your pack. But I'll just put it in the little bag that it comes with. And that's it all packed up. It's just a really good stove. It doesn't cost very much and it's dual fuel. So if you're looking for something to provide you with food, and it has to be said, a little bit of heating and warmth, if you're either out in the woods or out camping, or the gas and electricity have just been cut off. You've now got a solution that will allow you to cook your food and keep yourself warm, provided you take some very basic safety precautions and you respect the fact that you have contained fire. But it's a very easy way of doing it. It's extremely efficient, and it means that you don't have to chop down trees or search for firewood. You literally put small twigs and sticks in it, which, if you're anywhere near trees, are going to be very easy to find. I give this a massive thumbs up, and it's something that I always take camping. So here's me with the wired microphone, and I'm probably going to harp on about this quite a bit. If you do want to learn to prepare yourself for suddenly all the utilities being switched off, or you want to learn how to fend for yourself, get out to your local woodland. Go out. If you do buy kit, try it in an environment where you don't have any backup, you don't have any option. If you want that cup of tea or you want your meal to be once you've gone the sufficient distance from home, you will figure out how to do fire. But we'll be covering how to light fires in later episodes. But yeah, get out in the woods. Learn to look after yourself, learn to be comfortable. And that's the trick. Any idiot can be uncomfortable. It takes skills to become comfortable in your chosen environment. And there are two squirrels having a fight next to me.